GP8 partner in the medical practice. Any policies for absence?
Council Bill Davis is not here. Council Jeff Green, Sheena Hermesy, David Allison, Annette Roberts, the other Bill Davis from Power Watch. I think this, you know, so far, yes, we just.
Yeah, not much to say, so it's.
It's what I'm hearing.
Four.
And Fish?
Thank you very much.
I'm going to Janelle, that goes for Ted Dawson and Sally, and so.
This year.
And could we have John Dealing's, apologies?
We've got two lots of minutes to approve. The minutes of the Capitol report on, the formal report on the 16th of November. We have a report on the 23rd of January. Is everybody had a chance to travel up? They have the advice line, this is a free record.
This is like, yeah, I'm on board with the minutes, I'm just trying to check which ones it is, it's happening down, there's, been had a, community trust, which you can see.
Oh, yeah. The next item is item four, community pharmacy scrutiny report.
Thank you, Chair.
Could you possibly put the microphone on, please? Thank you. Thank you very much, thank you.
Thank you, I am conscious that we have a member of the group that has been doing scrutiny review, so I know Councillor Chris really wants to comment as well, but Councillor London is unable to be here this evening to present the report. But it is a piece of scrutiny work that was carried out by members of the People's Scrutiny Committee, looking at community pharmacies and really reviewing the opportunities that we can make from the community pharmacy, I think, as a borough. The report makes a number of recommendations which have implications for partners, really. So, and also, I'm very conscious that the relationship with community pharmacies is one that many members of the RTMRB board have, so it's really important that the board is cognizant of that. And in fact, there was a request in the report for it to be brought here. And I think it's worth me just highlighting that as a board, we are formally responsible for producing a pharmaceutical needs assessment every 3 years, which requires us to assess the capacity of our community pharmacy and the needs we have in relation to community pharmacy. So this report has some relevance to that responsibility. And I think if I can just let the members of the board know that we are about to start updating the pharmaceutical needs assessment that will be published in May 2018. So obviously we will take this report into account as we go through some of that process too. I am conscious that there are members of the committee here, and I think Councillor Davis and the audience also is a part of it. So you may well want to make some specific comments, but there are a number of recommendations that are there for the board in some comments.
Has
everybody had a chance?
Yes, Bill. Yes, I'd like to say that this started with a notice of motion that Councillor Lady Mitchell and myself put to Council. It was submitted at a time of controversy in that service about change of funding. It was a time of uncertainty when no one in part of the sector could
that a self-care policy was undertaken at the governing body last autumn, and as of November, it was came into fruition that the governing body felt that those for minor conditions, cough, cold, sore throats, other minor conditions, we should be encouraging self-care and self-responsibility by the public. So, as a result of that, GPs for minor conditions do not prescribe items for those. And therefore, in line with that, I think pharmacy, which had two levels, as this report correctly said, no longer fitted with the governing body policy for level one. So level one was removed, level two remains, as correctly put here. But it's the sentence, and as a result, we'll have to visit the GP for a free prescription, is not correct. So there is no prescribing, regardless of what category you're in for your prescriptions, no prescribing for minor ailments, very minor ailments, not ongoing, so to encourage self-care. So that final comment in that middle paragraph is incorrect. About this is in GP.
Councillor Archie Davis was part of the scrutiny review. Would you be happy to take that back your scrutiny panel?
Yeah. Sorry, I couldn't say it.
Yeah.
I'm not part of the audience. I can certainly take that back. And I mean, we have asked as well that a report comes back to us in terms of what the impact of the changes were, because there wasn't a local kind of impact assessment that had been done or any screening by the different people that we interviewed. So we have asked for it to come back to people that interviewed the screening committee, and obviously for us to see to make sure that there's kind of no detrimental impact. So we'll take that.
I've looked at the list of names where early pharmacies are, and this mistake, there's been one of the same queries in Auckland for about the last 4 or 5 years, and certainly not on the list. And it's got the most used ones in the whole world. I don't know if that's a true mistake.
I'm not sure whether we've got this.
on from that as part of the commitments that were made by NHSE in regard to the GP five-year forward view and the need for us to increase general practitioners within the region of about 5,000 over the next 5 years. NHSE this year has introduced an induction and refresher scheme to enable GPs that have been absent from practice for a while for a whole variety of reasons, career breaks, different roles, etc., or for GPs who have practiced elsewhere, abroad, etc., and to come and join the NHS in England. The induction returner schemes a process by which GPs need to be able to join the NHS performance list. And for some it can be quite a complex process that we identified would be better supported with some direct kind of care and case management than individuals. The schemes, the support that's been put in place is actually hosted by the Cheshire and Merseyside scheme. So Cheshire and Merseyside team, so within my team there's a group of individuals who are supporting at the moment in the region of about 300 GPs that have already applied to National Director for Mental Health came up to visit us on the 24th of February. He's an actual National Policy Director and spent time in Wirral, particularly the Cheshire World Partnership. He's growing up in mental health services, amongst other things. And of course, she also had a look at cancer as well, particularly to highlight the really broad scheme that we've got all high hopes of, I think, with regard to community based growing up in mental health services, which we'd hope be successful to grow out across the whole of Cheshire and Wallasey. Do I have to take any questions?
Anybody any comments or questions? Yes.
Fishing expedition, really. Probably Nicola won't have an answer, but our partners might have an answer. And because of the reference you've made to the induction scheme for GPs qualified elsewhere, try and tread carefully on this one. Given the national debate about Brexit, the impact, people coming to work here or not, do our partners have a figure for how many staff who work in our NHS services in our region have come here and we couldn't manage it out?
So from an NHS England's point of view, we wouldn't hold that data. That would be workforce data that was held by individual organisations. With regard to the induction refresher scheme, I see no reason why we wouldn't be able to look at the number of people who are interested and have expressed an interest in applying to join the NHS performance list. But as I said, the sum total of that at this point in time, given that the scheme has only been launched in August, is 300 people at this moment in time, and that's nationally. So this isn't a huge scheme in terms of workforce numbers, but it's an area where we wanted to improve the service that we were providing to GPs that might be interested in coming to work in the NHS. At the moment, we seem to be until we introduce the scheme, we seem to be saying, yes, we really want you, and then putting up lots of bureaucratic barriers about whether or not they were able to go to join the list. That's the point of that scheme. Tell them through. Don't look at anybody else.
I just wanted to ask you on the mental health sort of issue. Stopping benefits for people with mental health problems and that. And so saying it's not a visible illness, so depression and that is not being classified as an illness. And quite often those people were using that money for either for cognitive behavioural therapy or antihistamine therapy or getting sort of assisting people to help them sort of get out to that. I'm just wondering what impact that might have on sort of GP practices and other sort of, because it seemed to me to be working, but that the money has been stopped. What are those people going to do?
I'm not in a position to comment on benefits.
No, I'm just a connection with specifically to do with people who've got mental health problems to say it's not visible illness, not physical illness, therefore we stop that.
So the expectation in terms of the challenge that NHS England has given itself and its partners in terms of CCGs is that we ensure that we ensure that there's an equal investment in mental health as there is in physical health. So it's no longer acceptable, if I use as an example that a CCG may be given a budgetary uplift and chooses to put all 5% of that, picking things out here, 5% of that budgetary uplift in physical health and not for any additional investment in mental health. They have to be able to demonstrate that they've matched that budgetary uplift in mental health. So that's the first thing. Second is that we have started for a number of years now. I think we introduced in 2015 was when we really started to become better at data collection, but there's a national data set with regards to mental health. It isn't as comprehensive as yet as physical health, but the expectation is that we will be moving, or we are moving ever closer to gaining a better data set with regards to mental health that will be more on par with the kind of data sets that we would gather around cancer, for example. And part of that is that we're looking very closely at the kind of therapies that you just mentioned. So most of those therapies would come under what we would call IAPT services, so basically the talking therapies and so on. challenges, but there's also a lot of good work underway to try and address those.
Yeah, I just wondered whether some of the work we talk about there is actually challenging perceptions around mental illness and about how is it or we tackle some of that stigma that's still associated with mental illness and mental distress and accepting it, you know, alongside physical health. So I think that was just absolutely.
And actually linked to that, one of the pieces of work that we're collectively talking about, and I've been talking to the Strategic Clinical Network about, which we've gotten with the CCGs and the providers, is that very thing around some kind of initiative over the forthcoming year, later on in the year, because we need to be sure the services can respond to demand, which really challenges that whole misconception. And also the misconception around the fact that early intervention has proven to be really effective, so getting help as soon as you can.
Yes, so just to agree with Nicola that there's a considerable amount of work in the CCG to try and improve a range of mental health services, including, as you say, the IACT services. And another important metric which is being monitored is recovery. So it's not just how quick you get into the services, it's how effective the service is for you. And that will continue to be closely monitored.
And I think just picking up on some of the developments that are happening both within rural and across the region is around the perinatal and the investment that's coming to perinatal and the impact that will have across the life course of individuals, and it may be that the board would want to receive some further information with regards to that in the future, but that is one of the developments that we will be able to see some real tangible outcomes around that.
Sure. Did you say that the talking therapies could access those within 6 weeks? Is that, did you say?
I said that we monitored.
We monitored.
Yeah. I have looked at the figures for Wirral. Part of your routine.
I'm going to handle food in my head, but that is monitored and as part of the performance review that comes to the governing body on a monthly basis.
Anybody else? No? Can I thank you very much for your service? It's quite a lot in here. It's quite
a lot. Yes, it's not too long, isn't it?
Can I welcome Detective Chief Inspector Martin Earl and Constable Amy Sherwen to give a presentation?
Okay, please. We're going to stand in front of
yes.
We've got the PowerPoint, so hopefully you can all hear us. First, thank you very much for inviting us here today to speak to you about mental health triage card, Wellasey High Priest Club, partnership with CWP and other partners around the room. We'll mention triage card and then go on to the triage card action plans that we now have put in place in relation to triage cards. It is an excellent piece of collaborative work between ourselves and the partners, a service that promotes integration while providing quality of care and reducing demand for our services and costs. Following the presentation, I'm hoping that for yourselves as a board, it will endorse and endorse and approach the strategy wherever possible. Influence commitments for future operation of the vehicle, and also suggest any improvements that you may have for the vehicle in going forwards. So, a background to mental health and the triage car in Merseyside. I cannot take any credit for the triage car or the TCAP process that we've got in place at the moment. That is all down to Hayley and Detective Superintendent Tim Keel, who's since retired. I've only been in the post 8 weeks and I'm immensely impressed with it already from what I see. Cllr, and all the local authorities and acute trusts. We need to improve our data collection. You've already spoke about data collection a short time ago, and that is something that is happening, and we are getting better at that all the time. We need to look at repeat 136 people, and that's hopefully what we're doing with the action plans and the TCAP process. And we need to understand everybody else's protocols, so MLAS, the Mental Health Act, we need to really create all of those. So this is a graph showing the average time, and you may not be able to see that, but in the blue bars are the number of 136 detections, and the red line across the middle is the time that it's taken for those mental health, that section 136 mental health process to take place. Now, as I said earlier, 2011 we were at 9.2 hours, and you can see the average there has come down to four, just over 4 hours. On the Wirral, it's currently 5 hours, 55 minutes, which is pretty much on the table. Those are very different in that they've got Wixon Hospital, which is a 136 unit. Southport are, again, struggle because they're on the boundary with Lancashire, a lot of the patients are from Lancashire that we see. But that's sort of an insight into the data that we collect now. Now, the place of safety for the world is our park, and it goes without saying that the length of time that the 136 process takes is a demand on our resources, both police and within the hospital, and within our hospital. However, what's the most important thing, taking away demand and everything, is the patient journey. So that person who is suffering from acute mental health illness needs to be treated with care and compassion. And we think by reducing the time, put the right people in the right place at the right time, we are reducing that suffering from the victim. So the ability for ourselves to measure the average time, as I said, is becoming a lot better, and a particular establishment volume and the wait time. And we can even narrow it down into times of day when all the everything takes place. So going forward, we need to understand our app provisions. We need the doctors and psychiatrics provisions. The fitness for a lot of time is spent waiting for fitness to be assessed. So if the person is drunk or on drugs, or indeed if they've got an injury that needs to be treated prior to the assessment, that's where a lot of the time is being taken. And in addition, in May 2017, a couple of months, is the police and crime bill that's also being introduced, which puts extra emphasis on all of this. So the objectives of the street triage car, to reduce overall numbers of people detained on a 136. As we've seen, the numbers have significantly decreased. We are currently at 474, so that's 474 so far this year, and that comes out to April. So within, we've got less than a month left, and we're at 474, so that's reduced significantly. And I'd anticipate probably about 150. However, more recently, we've been able to fully and truly examine the extent of the demand, utilising a compare and contrast exercise with partners, which has enabled us to understand our 136 demand for the first time. We are currently improving this data quality to the beginning of the financial year. Hayley will talk a little bit about that in a short time. We increased the percentage of the people detained on 136 who are referred for treatment, so getting them treated early, and we talked about prevention already here today, and therefore identifying correctly individuals who need assistance, are in crisis and in need of help, and divert other individuals appropriately, which again Hayley will go into. So we need to reduce time for officers spent at places of safety and the impact that that has on the hospitals, improve the quality of the intervention with both professionals and partners being applied in a collaborative manner, so
any policing incident with a mental health component. And by mental health component, we mean a police officer's understanding of a mental health component, so not that specific expertise of somebody who works in mental health services. And obviously the practitioner is there to make decisions, can conduct assessments, can refer for mental health acts, and to support the police officer. Often, as you would expect, there might be a mental health component, but there might be a social component for, you know, the children, there might be antisocial behaviour. So often it's a big picture that we have to problem solve. And what sometimes police officers do, we get a lot of people who are often under the influence of alcohol, who then say, I'm going to harm myself. And we have not got that expertise to make a decision as to whether they are or not. And the only options we've got available are section 136 if they're in a place where the public have access. And if they're not in a public place, we are very limited. We've got mental capacity act if they haven't got capacity, but on most occasions they have got capacity. So often it's about persuading, perhaps using relatives, and our only option is A&E. And that's why you will always see lots of police officers at A&E with different individuals, because we cannot, we are quite risk averse. What we often do as well is medicalise an issue, which practitioners will come along and say, that's absolutely not a mental illness. And then we should then go back to, you know, looking at criminal justice disposals. Sometimes we're thinking it's a mental health problem and actually the person's drug disorder. And instead of taking that person to A&E, we should perhaps be using our custody suites. So that collaborative decision at scene is really